Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
Gracious Father, we want to thank you very much for all that you have done to us, for us, in this MLR. Thank you for your word that has come line upon line, precept upon precept. Here a little, there a little. We see you doing the new thing that you have promised. Surely we can sense, we can feel, we can perceive your presence amongst us. And we know that where you are going, since you know where you are going, we can relax in your hands and know that you will take us there step by step. As we look at this third dimension of our challenge that pertains particularly to the young, we pray that you will speak to our hearts. We pray that you will strike our heart in such a way that all of us will be mobilized, not only into evangelism, but into this crucial aspect of evangelism, battling for the souls of young men. Thank you because we know you have heard us. We pray with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Engaging the battle for the young, the tools and the means. Like I said, the first thing to look at is to recall how this battle for the young began. And for those of us who are conversant with this battle for the young, you will remember that in the year 2004, I suppose, in Boko, we held the first battle for the young. The theme of that congress is we held the first Students' Congress. And the theme for that Students' Congress was Now That You Are Young. And during the opening charge of that meeting, God spoke to us in a very definite manner from the Epistle of John, the second chapter of the first Epistle of John, verse 13. And the Lord was speaking about this battle for the young from 1 John chapter 2, verse 13. You will see now that God was talking about the young people. I write unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father. Now, as the word of God came to us that particular year, we saw that God addressed the fathers. He addressed the young men and then addressed the little children. And we saw that life is divided into those three phases in life. And you will discover that the first stage of life is when you are a child, when you are a toddler. You have no control over anything that is done to you. And then, as you grow on, you become a young man, a young woman, a youth that is in control of several aspects of your life. And finally, you get to the old age, and you discover that the old age is only a time of reaping what we have sown in our youth. That charge came to us very strongly, showing us the fact that when you see a man in his old age, who is haggard and battered and troubled in life. The things that made him like that did not happen to him when he became old. The things that happened and make people scattered and haggard in life happened to them, or it was programmed into their future right from when they were young. That is the space in between childhood and manhood. That's what you call the youth, the young person, the young man, the young woman. And we saw in that message that day, God was saying that life for the young man or the young woman is a battle. There's a battle over his soul. There's God on one side wanting to fulfill his purpose in the life of that child, of that young man. There is the devil on the other side who is saying, no, God's purpose will not come to pass. But the battle rages on until the young man or the young woman makes his or her own choice. The choice is in the hands of the young man. It is whatever a young man does when he is young that will settle what is going to be when he grows older. Whatever will be later in life is settled while you are young. And I want every one of us listening to me, I want you to be listening for yourself as an individual, but also to be listening with a view of seeing that most people, young people around us, their lives are being settled. Their future are being settled. Their futures is being programmed. It's being decided. Whether the young man knows it or he doesn't know it, that is what is happening to him. Whether he likes it or not, what he's going to be when he becomes an old man is being done right now that he's young. And unfortunately for the young man of today, he's living in a far more perilous time than somebody like me lived in. The other day, I was having a family altar with my children. And I was lamenting. I was shaking my head. I said, I'm sorry for you. The times you are growing up as young people, as teenagers, is different from when I grew up. When I grew up, the challenges were less. When I was a teenager, what was the greatest thing I could smoke? Cigarettes. If I wanted to smoke India hemp, I will need to really, really struggle to find out where they sell it. But right now, marijuana joints are everywhere. And marijuana is a very small thing now. There are hard drugs. There's all kinds and manners of things to do. Sin seems to be so easy. I call it sin on demand. You can get practically anything you want as a young man. All you need to do, especially in this internet age, is just go on air and Google it out. You can find out how to do anything on the internet. I'm sorry to tell you, including the things that are going to destroy you. In my own days, if I wanted to watch a bad film, I have to plan. Number one, I will have to save money from my pocket money gradually, to save money to go to a film house. Then I have to plan how I will sneak out in the night without letting my parents know. I used to be a rascal before I gave my life to Christ, like all of us anyway. And in those days, I would do many things. Sometimes tie a rope to the leg of my junior sister and pull it out of the window so that when I return at 2 a.m. or 3 a.m., I can pull her leg and she can come and open the door for me. I have to do all kinds of manners of such planning in order to go and watch a bad film. And even at that time, if I want to watch a bad film, what is the level of bad film that I can watch? Kung Fu films. Indian films where they are singing and that's all the bad films, love films. That's all I can watch. But today, the average youth has pornography on his palms. On that small internet, he can go anywhere and watch anything, including live sex. This is Google age. Mobile internet age. A woman was telling me of an experience. Maybe the experience is even too intimate, but let me share it and cover it a bit. The mother looked at the young man, and you know how men wear their trousers and their manhood is not properly arranged, and it will be showing. So the mother said, "Hey boy, go and meet your daddy to teach you how to pack that thing very well." The boy looked at the mother and said, "Mommy, don't worry, I'll Google it." Anything, everything can be found on the net. This is mobile age. The worst and the best are in the palm of the young man. Everywhere he goes, whatever he wants to do, he has access to it 24 hours. In those days, if I bought something to eat, let's assume that I stole money, and I bought maybe suya or something to eat, I have to wait until the late in the night and cover my head with my blanket and be eating it under the... Today, the average youth has access to almost any sinful thing he may want. These are perilous days indeed. The battle for the soul of the young man is by far much more fierce than in my own days, than in your own days. Most of us that are in our middle age and are going older now, we will remember that it is possible. I remember when I was very young, they can put boys and girls together in the same room. We sleep on the same mat. We sleep on the same bed. Nothing happens. You dare not try that today. Even the child of 7 years is already watching pornography. A woman was in the same house with his seven or nine-year-old daughter. They were the only two in the house. And the woman, after some days, took her phone and he saw that somebody has gone to a pornographic site. So he called his daughter. "Did you?" He said, "No, mommy." I said, "What do you mean by that? There are only two of us." When he beat the girl very well, he said, "How did you know it?" He said, "My friend in school showed me how to watch those films." The battle for the soul of the young man is much fiercer than we have ever experienced it. And when we had this message on the battle for the young, and we saw that God is on one side, the devil is on one side, and that night, many young people came to give their life to Christ. How many were we? I don't know, maybe we were less than 3,000 or 4,000 students that were gathered in Goko that year. And we were excited. Oh, the matter, we edited the message and sent it out, and we forgot about it. Many years, I don't know how many years, I can't remember now, maybe after some 10 years or so, God began to challenge us that if one message helped one person, it can help 1,000. Of course, our first excitement is that, oh, okay, our first response is we edited it, we packaged it, we produced it in thousands, and we started sending it everywhere. It was being sold everywhere. It was being distributed free of charge everywhere. But then God came around and said, "That's not what I'm talking about. The battle for the young is not just a message. The battle for the young is a program, and heaven is looking for those who he can recruit in order to get involved in that battle." So we set up task forces. We began to pray. We began to find out what are we doing. How can we do this battle for the young? Because God was speaking to us not to be like Samson, who killed 1,000 people with the jawbone of an ass, and then he threw it away. That one bone, if he could kill 1,000, he can kill 1,000,000. And it became a project, it became a battle, it became a program in our hands. Today, I seek to involve you in that battle for the young. I seek to make you involved in reaching for the souls of young people. And I would like to share with you some disturbing statistics that I saw as I prepared for this meeting. Of course, I discovered that the World Statistics, World Population Bureau, or whatever name they are called, classified the people living in the world into three ages. Ages 0 to 14 are called children and adolescents. And ages 15 to 65 years are called the working population or population that are still in education or who are economically active. And then over the age of 65, which are retirees and elderly people. I was disturbed when I saw the graph. I don't know whether you can see the graph very well. If I go back and let you see the previous slide, the ages 15 to 65. Maybe that age group is too wide, but that's how they classified it. And of course, when I saw the graph, I found out that for the blue, which is showing the 0 to 15, they're about 41% generally. 41, 35, 24, 30%. But the second group, which is the large group of the youth, they are almost about 60%, 65, 67, 60, consistently 60 in all the continents of the world. The first one up is Africa. The next one is the entire world population. The next one is the Latin America. The next one is Asia. The next one is the Oceania, North America, and Europe. You see that almost everywhere, the youth have the highest population. But then, this is even more disturbing. In terms of volume, and look at this graph. At bottom zero, age 0 to 4, you have the highest. But as you go up, you discover that the volume is reducing. The volume is reducing. Male is on the left side, female is on the right side. You see the volume is reducing. By age 40, let me go to the next slide, which is a bit more descriptive. You see, the first from 0 to 15, they are called dependents. They don't take decisions. Decisions are taken for them. Resources are given to them. People pay their school fees, all of that. But from age 19 or 20, age 19 to 64, according to this graph, they are called the economically active. They are called the education population. They are called the youth. So the people we are dealing with, even if I don't take it up to 65, even if I take it to 45, they form more than 50% of every population. And if that is true, why should we sit down? If we are reaching some old women and we are reaching some young people, we are not reaching the bulk of the population. The world population currently says we are about 7.8 billion. The male are about 3.9 billion. The female is about 3.8 billion. I used to think that women are more than men, but I am discovering that there are more men than women. Now, but I hope you are listening to me. People that have been born this year up to now, they are already 147 million. Up to yesterday, 147,744,736. And birth yesterday was 271,983. Whereas death, up to yesterday, 57 million. So you have 147 minus 57 and you have 90 million. So the population is growing. This represents an army of toddlers and young people that are going to become youth in the next 15 years. And people are not dying as much as they are being born. So more people are being added to the youth population on a yearly basis, on a daily basis. More people are becoming youth. And yet the scripture says in Colossians chapter 1 verse 18, he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. In all things he might have the preeminence. And I was asking, does God actually want to have preeminence in all things? Does he want to have the preeminence in numbers? Is he planning that the preeminent number of human beings will be in heaven? Or God has resigned and he has told himself, well, more people can go to hell. It doesn't matter. The more I look at the word of God, the more I see that God is interested in getting as many people to heaven as possible. Now, where are these young people? Where are these youth? Where are these teeming population that are the vast majority in the world? Where are they? They are in homes. They are in campuses. They are on the internet. They are in the movies. They are in sports. They are on the streets. And I'm going to take this one by one as we look very quickly. Number one, they are in our homes. So how do we reach these young people who are in the homes, who are growing up? These bats that we are talking about happens in the homes, and they grow up until teenage years, up until the early youth, before they are released to go and live on their own. And if you are going to get involved, I would like to begin to challenge your heart to do certain things deliberately. Number one, I said, they can be reached by deliberateness. Most of us Christians, even the children that are growing in our houses now, and I'm sorry to say, even in the houses of some of us disciples, vagabonds are growing in our houses. Our children are as wayward as people outside. It's pathetic. It's painful. I don't know why it is that a generation who served God, who loved God, who followed God, oftentimes their next generation are not godly. The next generation are not serving God. The next generation do not love God. If we look at the population of disciples whose children are in discipleship classes, very low. And it is because sometimes we are not deliberate. We think if we just leave them a family altar, we take them to church, we take them to this, they will become godly. No, it doesn't happen like that. If your child is going to turn out right, if your child is going to turn out as a Christian, if your youth is going to become a godly youth, you have to be deliberate. Deliberate teaching, deliberate instruction, deliberate. The word deliberate is a major factor, a major tool in the hand of anyone who is going to grow a correct disciple out of your homes. Secondly, by friendship. Now, when these children were young, when they were toddlers, you can shout on them. You can bring out a cane. You can threaten them. For the young man, that doesn't work. For the teenager, for the young man that is still living in your house, he's already a young man. You can't be threatening him any longer. Rather, I've discovered that friendship is better. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, he says, fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath. Forbearing threatening. Sometimes we easily threaten. If you don't do this, I will do that. For the child, that can work. For the young man, it doesn't work. I found out that if you deliberately become their friend, you get involved in their lives, you show personal interest in what they show personal interest in. If he has a craft, if he has a skill, you get involved, you begin to become his friend. You invite them, you play with them. Sometimes, just to play orange as football in your compound can be the opportunity to get involved in these young lives. And when they are becoming older, when they are hitting their teenage, they are hitting their early 20s, you have to do something more. buy a table tennis into your house so that you can have an opportunity of interaction. Look for something where you and the children can interact. Small games in the house where you can play together. And where you are playing, you can be passing the instructions. It is not only in family altar that discipleship can take place. By deliberate personal interest in these lives, by involvement, and of course, by godly instructions. Even though I am talking about all of this, and I'm saying that Bible study is not the only thing, definitely we have to use Bible studies. We have to take them to church. We have to encourage them to do their quiet time. We have to train them in all of these things. But then they are not only homes. Most of their youth are in our campuses. And the chief implement in reaching the youth on our campuses will be the use of media materials. The use of materials. Books and tapes and several other small materials that can introduce people to God. Let me quickly run through this before I show you some of the materials that are available for us to use in this evangelism to reach young people. We are talking about people, particularly for me, and more particularly about people from age 15 right up to 28, 30. That's the bulk. They may not be 67%, but they are over 50%. And they are in the campuses. We need to use friendship evangelism. Now, and at this point, I think I need to also say to us that the people who can reach the youth in all sincerity are the youth themselves. It is Christian youth that hold the key to the evangelism of the unbelieving population around us. God was talking to Ezekiel. I think that's in Ezekiel chapter 3. He said, I have not sent you to a people of a strange language, whose language you cannot understand. Every generation has its own characteristics, their language, their culture, their dressing, their mannerisms. And if you don't belong to a generation, it's difficult to reach that generation. You have to become like Paul. Paul said, I became all things to all men so that I can at least save some. Maybe not everybody has that grace. But the young man does not need to become anything different. He's already in the same generation with young people. I want to challenge the young people listening to me today. Incidentally, in our own statistics also, you are almost 50% of MLR. If God will mobilize you and push you out to reach people your own age, people in your own class, people in your own school, people in your own profession, as young professionals, people in your own business, if you will reach out to people who have the same characteristics as you, the same language, the same way of dressing, the same way of talking, the same, you think like them, you talk like them. You can be their friends easily, and you can reach them easily by personal witnessing, by invitation to meetings. Let me quickly run through. Of course, the book, Battle for the Young, we turned it into a book, and it's been translated into several languages. We have it in Spanish, in Portuguese, in French, even in Arabic. If I move a bit for you to see the man in Arabic, on the screen, and of course in English. We have it in Russia. We have it in some of these other languages already printed, which you can utilize. And we produce this particularly interesting version during the sporting session. I will still talk about that when I start talking about youth being in sports. But we had an outreach during the National Sports Festival, and we produced a special edition for that session. But let me move ahead quickly. There are other materials that you can use, like dynamics of fulfilling your mandate, God's commitment to you, your new beginning in Christ, and finding the bones of your bones. All these materials are available in many of our centers. Right now, in several of the centers, These are books that are deliberately geared to reaching the youth. I encourage you to get into it. Now, I have said before, these youths are on the internet. How do we reach them on the internet? It's time for Christians to get involved. We can no longer sit away and say the internet is for the devil. We said the television was for the devil many years ago, and we left it, and the television stole away our children. We must not do the same thing with the internet. We must get involved, encourage our children, encourage disciples to write applications with Christianity in mind. I want to inform you that many of the applications we are using today, they did not have Christ in mind. Many of them are godless people who wrote just for money's sake. We have to get involved in application writing. We have to get involved in building websites that can reach the young people. That's where they are. Christians have to get involved in writing blogs, whether you are young or old. Write in a language that the people can get. Produce tracks. These days, there's a new trend of podcasts. These are regular, how do I describe them? Regular broadcasts that are not put in the radio. They are regular podcasts. They are small files, audio files that are sent to people's inbox on a daily basis. I've stumbled into podcasts in the devices of my sons. And I see that there are preachers that they are following. They are listening to them every day. Some of them are producing this 15-minute podcast every day. Some are producing it once a week. But do you know what happens? Whoever somebody is listening to will form that person's theology, will form that person's lifestyle, will form that person's perspective to life. We have to get involved. We have to do podcasts in video, in audio. We have to write blogs. We have to write columns. We have to get on social media. I ran away from social media for many years until I discovered that the young people I'm looking for, they are no longer on email. They are no longer on the magazine, on the pages of magazine, physical hard copy. They are not there. They don't read it. They are glued to their devices 24/7. I had to come into social media, even though quietly, in order to use it. And I've seen it very useful. We've had programs that we just created a group on social media and asked everybody who registered to pour into that group. And I see thousands of people pouring into it. And they gave an opportunity to speak to them regularly, send messages to them, send some of our tapes, send some of our materials. And I discovered that people are being helped. People are contacting me privately and looking for counseling. We need to get involved. We need to. There's something they do on Facebook. They call it watch parties. Somebody will invite his friends. He would send out a notice on Facebook. I'm going to be watching this movie. Can you join me? And you see people joining. They want to do a watch party. They are in their different places all over the world. Can we not do watch parties of many of these messages that have changed our own lives? We need to get involved. Now these people are in the movies. We have to raise disciples in the drama ministry. We cannot leave it for the entertainment industry alone to fill the whole place with rubbish. We thank God for several of our brethren who have drama ministries, and they are doing a good work. More is needed. More professionalism is needed. More spirit-filled drama catches are needed so that we can use this in outreaches. But beyond that, we can get involved in sponsoring TV programs. If we are going to have drama that is going to affect young people, there's a new trend they have. They call it season. You have season one, season two, season three. One single drama is going on for 1 year, and it's coming out every week. Some are going on for years. I've seen one drama. They say they are on season 36. And people are glued to it. They are following it. And I remember some two drama series on our television in those days that affected the people. One is called Another Life. It was a foreign, and it went on for almost 2-3 years. Every evening, I think it was only for 25 minutes or something. Every evening, people were, and of course, we remember our own Agbara Nla by the Mount Zion production. In those days, when it is time for Agbara Nla in Nigeria, you can't get taxis outside. Taxi drivers, Okada riders, they are all packed. We need to get involved in such things so that we can get this teeming population and give Christ the preeminence. These people are in sports. We have to get involved in sport outreaches. We need to get involved in sponsoring disciples into sports. We need to get involved in sponsoring tournaments or getting involved in tournaments. I think it was 2014 when the World Cup was taking place in Brazil. The publishing team decided to sponsor some of our brethren abroad to go and do an outreach for us. And we sent about, I think, three of our brethren. And they were joined by some other disciples in Brazil. And it was such a wonderful outing. If I have space, if I don't finish all my time, I'll play a video of one of our brothers. I'll play it for us at the end. But I have some pictures which I can flash for us to see quickly. We sponsored, you can see our own brother Charles wearing the Battle for the Young in Portuguese. That was on the streets. He was distributing Battle for the Young. He joined the crowd that were watching. They didn't go to sit down. But the people that were going into the stadia, they were distributing these books. We printed, I think, about 100,000 copies of this book and shipped it to Brazil. And it was distributed in Portuguese, in French, and a little in English. You can see him in the photo below. He was speaking to students in a school. He would give them a short charge and then distribute it. And one of our brothers that also followed him, I think his brother Ike, you can see him doing one-to-one evangelism on the street. We went also to Rwanda, and you will see some of pictures from the meeting in Rwanda. You see one of our brothers, Brother Matthew, preaching, and Charles was out distributing the books on the streets. And you see the last picture down is altar calls at such a retreat. We can do this. There are sports tournaments all around us. We can get involved. Carry these materials. Carry these tapes. Put it on the loudspeaker. Set up a stand. Be playing the message while the tournament is going on. All of this is possible. Somebody will be interested. Somebody will come and ask you, who is the preacher? Who is saying that thing? And then you have opportunity to witness. These children are on the streets. These young people, not just children, these young people are on the street. Unfortunately, in third world Africa, many of our young people are on the streets. They are not even in schools. They are on the streets. They don't have the wherewithal to go to school. We must reach them. The fact that they are not educated does not mean we have to leave them to go to hell. We can get involved in street evangelism. We can do what we call Jesus marches. To do a Jesus march, you just get some vehicles. Sometimes you get a tractor. Sometimes you get a whole trailer and cause commotion somewhere. And then we park. And then we start preaching with music. And things are going on. Young people on the streets will gather almost immediately. It happens all the time. I have been involved in several of it, and I see that it's very effective. Very soon, you can find a crowd to preach to. They are there on the street. And finally, we have to get involved in raising disciples. Raising disciples. Several of our disciples now, several of us are just looking for children that will read engineering and law and medicine. I'm not running down any of those professions. But the bulk of the people are not lawyers and medical professionals. We have to sponsor disciples into every professional sphere. There's an army of fashion designers now. It's a serious industry. And they are designing clothes that will send people to hellfire. Where are the disciples that will design very fine, correct dresses and materials that will yet make people godly? I had a young man that came into my hand in discipleship. He read physics for his first degree. But this young man, when he will sit in the very brilliant young man, but he will sit in the physics class and he will be designing clothes. He was the one already sewing clothes for his faculty, sewing clothes. When he finished, he finished his first degree. He struggled to finish. I can't remember. I think maybe he made a 2-2. And then he came, he said, excuse me, I'm not following physics. I said, what do you want to follow? He said, everywhere I see that, I would just be dreaming and seeing sketches of designs of clothes. But I dare not tell my parents. I dare not tell my mother. They will not allow. I said, don't worry, I will help you. And we got involved. By the grace of God, this boy went to go and start school again. He went for a first degree in fashion designing. He's getting ready to do his master's. He's getting ready to do his PhD. He's involved in the, he's already designing. We need disciples like that. And he's designing and getting involved in occasions, in events. And sometimes he has an opportunity to present in very top places. And while he's doing his presentation, he's putting Christ. He's putting philosophies of Christ. He's using Proverbs. He's doing some of these things in order to project Christ. We have to do more of that. We have to sponsor people into entrepreneurial spheres. We have to sponsor people into all the professional spheres, particularly the internet. The internet will likely rule the next 20 years if Christ tarries. If our disciples are not there, we are not going to be in control. Anyone who is thinking of being a person of influence must be interested in reaching the youth. If you are intending for your labor and your work not to fizzle out 5 years after you have gone, you have to reach the youth. You have to reach the young people. They are the bulk. They are the ones that can outlive us. One of these years, I don't know what will happen to me. It just occurred to me that several disciples that I was raising, they were either same age with me, 5 years younger, 3 years, some of them were even older than me. Some of them, one or two of them, if they gave birth to a child in secondary school, they will have been my father. And God said, Larry, what are you doing? You have no disciples that will outlive you. And when that happened to me, I realized that the battle for the young is the battle for the soul of our population. The battle to reach the young is the battle to reach the world. If you are going to be involved, I thank God for my brethren who brought the challenge on missions and brought the challenge on aggressive evangelism. They made it look as if you become involved, God will anoint you. I thank God for that. But I was hearing the message this morning, and God was saying, you are responsible. You are responsible. A dispensation is committed into your hand. I was no longer hearing whether I will be anointed, whether I will not be anointed. It's not the issue. The issue is that I am in this generation. And every generation of preacher are responsible for its own generation of sinners. Every generation of youth are responsible for the generation of youth. If your population, your generation, if they are not in heaven, you will be held accountable. You will be held responsible. People like Paul understood this. He said, woe is me if I preach not the gospel. I'm praying that God will help each one of our lives, and God will take a deliberate challenge into our hearts. Pour a deliberate burden into our hearts that will make us to reach our generation. As I drag you to the place of prayer, I want to ask you, what are you planning to do with what you have had? I would like to ask those of you who are young people all over the centers, as you are listening to me, will your own generation be represented in heaven? Some of us, we have already reached several of our people of our generation. Many in our generation are born again and they are going to heaven. I'm not saying they are enough. But the matter is that if your generation goes to hell in bulk, I don't see how you will be in heaven and you will be happy. I don't see how you will be happy if there will not be tears. You know, when the Bible said, God shall wipe away the tears from our eyes in heaven, I used to ask myself, I thought they said heaven was a place of enjoyment. What will make somebody to cry? Now I'm discovering. For somebody to get to heaven and discover that there was something he could have done and he did not do, tears will come to your heart. There are people you could have brought to heaven and you did not take them, tears will come to your heart. And there is this massive population of young people teeming around us, milling around us, everywhere, every day, and you could have taken a chunk of them to heaven and you did not. Tears will come to your ears. Thank God, God will wipe away our tears. But I would rather be in heaven rejoicing than to be in heaven with tears day after day. Before I ask you to pray, I think it's better for me to ask you to pray. If I have time, I'll play a video of our brother doing a street evangelism somewhere at the end. But even if I don't have a chance to play that video, I would like you to bow down your heads with me now and to pray. I would like you to decide. The challenge of these 3 days, we had the challenge of missions. We had the challenge for aggressive evangelism. We had of men, hunters, who are hunting. What are you hunting for? As a young man, what are you hunting for? Are you still hunting for girls? You are hunting for money. I see young people, they say, I'm looking for money. I'm looking for money. The Bible says, the life of a man does not consist in the abundance of the things which he possesses. When you have gotten all of that and you cannot take it to heaven, of what use will it be? May God make you a hunter. Whether you are young, whether you are old, listening to me today, I want to challenge you to make a decision. This is the final call. This is the final chance, final opportunity for you to make a deliberate decision. What are you going to do? We have exposed you to several things that can be done. Can you make up your mind? I'm going back to my campus. I'm going back to my school. I'm going back to my office. I'm going back to my business in out reaching out to the souls of men. There are discipleship classes that can start in your workshop. You have a shop. You have many young apprentices, but there is no opportunity for them for discipleship. You engage them throughout the day, and you are not engaging them with the word of God. What are you planning to do? What is God going to write in your own account? What is God going to write in your own record that you did for Christ? God is calling you. This MLR, he said, pursue. There is time not to sit. And one of our brothers said, God did not tell the sinners to come to us. He told us to go to them. He told us to pursue them. Pursue your friends. Pursue even your enemies, if you have any. Instead of praying all the prayers of killing our enemies, you are going to prayer meetings where you are killing those that do not allow you to do to get a promotion. That's not what Jesus said. The soul of every human being on the earth belongs to our Father. And it pleases God that in all things, he will have preeminence. Will you be part of those who will make God to have preeminence? Will God on your own account be able to boast against the enemy and say, Satan, can you see I won the battle after all? Or in our own generation, the devil is going to laugh at God and say, yes, even though you will send me to hellfire, but I took more people to hellfire than you took to heaven. Who is there to come to the help of the Lord? Who is there? Who is on the Lord's side this evening? Is God calling you to drop all the useless things that you are doing to get involved in something that will be productive for heaven? God has been speaking to your heart. Now is the time to respond. Speak unto the Lord. Decide now that you are going to serve the Lord. As I pray with you, if you are making any such decisions, everywhere you are, I just want you to stand on your feet. I'm going to pray with you. That's all I have enough time to do now. Wherever you are, in all the centers, especially young people that are saying, I'm going back to get my generation. I'm going back after my own generation. I would like you to stand on your feet wherever you are. Stand to your feet. I'm going to pray with you. Stand to your feet and begin to speak to the Lord. Begin to tell the Lord, yes, Lord, you can count me. You will have preeminence in my own time. You will have preeminence in my own generation. God bless you. As you stand to your feet, God bless you. I'm going to be praying with you. I say, my own generation will not go to the dogs. My own generation will be represented in heaven. Our brother read the scripture the other day that Christ is looking for every tribe and tongue and language. Can I say to you, Christ is also looking for every generation. Speak to the Lord. Say, Lord Jesus, I will do my bit. My generation will be represented in heaven. Those who speak my language, those who speak my tongues, those who have the same characteristics with me, we are going to heaven together. I'm going to take as many people to heaven as I can. God bless you. God bless you. We are going to pray together. Father, we thank you. Thank you for this challenge that has come to us. Father, I pray that as many as are standing up all over the centers and they are making a decision to make you to have the preeminence in heaven, preeminence in numbers of the people that have lived upon the earth. 7.9 billion people are presently on the earth. Father, will they be represented in heaven? Father, we pray that you release fresh grace. Release your grace upon our lives. Release your grace upon this. Release your wisdom. Give us wisdom tips, what to do, how to approach it, how to do evangelism. Many of us do bad days. Our bad day can be turned to an outreach. Father, make this wisdom to begin to flow to us and banish every sense of shame. Shame that doesn't catch us when we go to watch football, but this shame will catch us when it is time to do evangelism. Father, we pray that you will affect our heart, change our thinking, change our philosophy of life, change our pursuit in life. Make us hunters, as you have said to us. We ask you in the name of Jesus. I pray for all this, my brethren, standing up, whether young or old, Lord, that in the next 1 year, they themselves will be able to see loads of souls that have come to Christ on our account. Loads of souls that have become disciples in our hands. Do this for us. We ask it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Almighty Father. We worship and exalt your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. A video of our brother in Brazil.